Hey, what's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Bot Squad Podcast. We are at episode number 69.
Oh, shit.
I knew he was waiting for that. I knew you were waiting for this number.
I just thought.
You damn liar.
I thought it was 68. No, I'm not lying for real.
Anyway, 69. Episode 69. We're almost there to 100. Not quite. We're not going to make our quota that we wanted for the year.
Yeah.
But I figure quality over quantity. You know what I mean?
Yeah, of course.
So what are we drinking today, man?
We are drinking an Indian Pale Ale Cerberus IPA, sorry. This comes to us from Odell Brewing Company. Actually, this just came from the store, but in the past, we've had people send us beer. But this, yeah, you can find this at your local Specs. And if you guys don't know what Specs is, or maybe y'all have a liquor store, a big name brand liquor store around where you live. And
Specs is one of the biggest.
Yeah.
I think, yeah. It's not only Texas, is it?
I don't know. Like for a long time, I only thought, like, Kroger's was here, you know? You know, or
Itchy Butt.
H-E-B is actually it is a Texas store.
Yeah. That one I know for sure is a Texas store.
Yeah. But anyways, this is an Indian Pale Ale. Let me see what else.
Trying to hide the fact that I was trying to open it with my hands, and it's not one of those.
It's not one of
those. I know.
All right. Well, good thing I drink a lot, so I got one hooked to my trusty
cheese. Trying not
here.
To show it off. Oh, look.
But it's 7.0% by alcohol.
Oh,
so,
wow.
Yeah, 7% alcohol. All right.
Man, that's pretty damn good.
Oh, hell, man. Right from the beginning. You know what this reminds me of? The smell?
What?
Remember those one beers? What are we? The one with the lion? The big ones. Remember you used to buy the big pints?
I think it's Three Lions.
Three
or
Lions,
something?
Yeah. Remember they had all like the herbs in them and everything?
The herbs.
Smell it.
Oh, yeah.
Not only IPA, but, you know, some of them other good stuff.
Look, it has some. It does have it in there. It's, they're floating
oh, it
around
does.
In there. Yeah, so it's pretty much the same.
All right.
Style, anyway. Ooh, that tastes good.
Damn, that's good.
That tastes really good. I was expecting something else. That's why I gave the ooh. All
right, I've had Indian Pale Ales before, and they're really good. This one's fucking good. When I saw Indian Pale Ale, I like Pale Ales, but Indian Pale Ale,
Pale Ale,
the universe, Pale Ale.
Yeah, no, this tastes really good. 7%, you said, right?
Yeah, it means today's gonna be a good podcast.
And this is from, and this is from where? Does it say where?
Odell Beckham, Odell Brewing Company.
Doesn't say exactly where though, right?
Ready to buck, what?
Colorado, Fort Collins, Colorado. Yeah, wow, really
all
good.
All right, Fort Collins, you know what's up?
Man, I'm really impressed by this one.
Yeah, good Colorado Mountains right there, see?
Colorado Mountains.
Apparently, elephants like to hang out in Colorado. In the mountains.
What?
Because the elephant, dude, right now.
Anyway, you know what? Speaking of elephants. All right, everybody's, you know, it's this time of the year where everybody starts, you know, decorating and stuff like that, their front yards.
Mm-hmm.
Randomly, I saw, you know, those inflatable things that people would put right down the street. It's a Santa Claus riding an elephant.
I saw it just right now.
Like, why?
Yeah, you know? I saw that.
That just reminded me. I'm like, what?
I took that turn, and when I took the turn, I looked, and I kept looking. I was like, what the fuck was that? Fucking elephant.
Anyway, so, all right, so we're going to go ahead and get on with the show here.
Oh.
I have a little question to ask you, man.
Okay.
Okay. You know, we're collectors. We collect many things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's anywhere from movies, toys, you know, all sorts of collectible figures. I'm not lumping toys with collectible figures because that's, to me, that's totally different.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Games, all sorts of stuff.
Yes.
Have you ever gotten to a point where you've made a big purchase and you've suddenly felt remorse over it? Like buyer's remorse. You know how some people get buyer's remorse where, like, you know, you buy something and then you're like, damn. And
what did you buy?
And then you start going back and forth with your... We'll get to that in a second. I love how you just went straight to that.
Yeah.
But has that ever happened to you?
I do it a lot. I do it too much to the point where I end up just putting my phone down because I buy a lot of shit on my phone. If not, or in the store, I walk away.
my wife would just go behind me and buy it. Well, she's like, if you don't get it, I'm gonna get it.
Well, look, have you ever like actually physically bought something and you leave the store and you're like, ah, fuck, maybe I should take it back.
Yeah, yeah, of course, yeah.
Or or you've gotten to the point where you're taking it back, you know, that kind of thing. You have, right?
Yeah, yeah, oh yeah, hell
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So.
Where is it?
Look, I'm really bad. No, it's not here. Uh-huh. Yet. I'm really bad about that. I guess that's one of the thing that is wrong in here with me, okay, in my brain.
In there.
Because occasionally, like, say, you know, I'll buy a figure, $20, whatever. Sometimes even $20 gets me, you know? But if I make a big purchase, like, say, more than $100, then and I'm physically walking out of the door. I'm physically walking out of the door with it. I will suddenly just have this guilt over me, and it just sinks in my stomach, and I'm like, maybe I should take it back. And on about a handful of occasions, I've actually walked back into the store and returned it, and then I've left the store. And then the next day, went back to go buy it again. And then I still feel guilty. I'm like, shut up, David. Shut up, brain. Shut up, David's brain. It's one of those, like, things. I have, like, I guess a malfunction.
You know what it is? It's just because there's so many of the things that are going on. And I know, because this happens to me. And when I pick up an item that I want, I just, what runs through my head is, you know, okay, where I have all the bills been paid, have all this been paid, you know, does my daughter need this? Does my son need this? Is the car fine? You know, all the responsibilities, have they been taken care of? You know?
Yeah.
I mean, also, depending on what it is, does David have multiples of these mothers? You know what I mean? That's what's getting to me, because I mean, if it was something he didn't have, then he would have told me. Like the other day when he bought like this Captain America Winter Soldier, like badass blue, you know, steel case thing, he had no problem telling me. He was like, well, you know, I know I spent a little bit of money on it, but you know what, I wanted it. It wasn't, you know, I bought it and I was like, man, maybe I shouldn't have got it, man. It wasn't none of that. So I know it's something that he doesn't own, and it's new. It's something new, isn't it? Right? Am I right? It's new, right?
No.
No? Damn, I was wrong. Yeah. Shit. It's a multiple? It's something you already had? God. Then you don't need it. No wonder you're thinking like that.
Look, okay. Let me just lay it out right here. I'm going to show you exactly what it is. All right. This is it. This is a Captain America Civil War. They call it a one click, okay? Because it, remember, like the Winter Soldier one that I have, it's four different ones, just like that, in one box where you can buy it in one go, right? Comes in this collector's box. It has, you know, Captain America and Iron Man on the cover. Comes with these little minifigures and stuff like that, and it's limited. They only made, I think, I want to say about 3,000 of them, something like that, in the world. It's coming from China. And so, yeah, I ordered that. Huh. And it's, I'm having this weird moment right now because I don't want to say how much it was.
Don't.
But it was pretty pricey, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I will just say that. All right, and I paid for it, and it went through whatever. You kind of have to go through with something like this. You have to go through like a third party kind of thing to get it shipped over here, kind of stuff. And they call them group buys.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
And I bought it, and then about 2 days after I paid for it, I'm over here like,
man,
sitting down. I'm like, oh my God, what did I just do? Yeah. What did I just do? And they pretty much give you the disclaimer on there. Once you pay for it, there's no going back on it.
Yeah.
You know, and in a way, I guess something like this will accrue value.
Yeah, of course.
You know,
yeah,
it
yeah.
will.
Hell yeah.
Because they're limited.
Limited, yeah.
But at the same time, I'm just like, oh my God, what did I do?
Like pops.
No, not like Pops.
Yes, yes, dude. There's
fine,
like
Pops.
Like stupid limits on all the time.
But you know, it was just something like this. I was like, you know, I can't. A part of me can't justify it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I'm trying to so hard, and I'm still fighting with myself back and forth. And I'm hoping that within the next week or so, I will settle down and just live with it.
You'll be
you know what I mean?
You'll be all right. As soon as it gets here, you'll forget. And then it'll be
probably.
Cool.
I plan on doing an unboxing.
Oh, really?
For that. At least for one of them. For one of the four that are there. Because pretty much they're all the same.
Yeah.
They just have different covers on them.
Hey, you know what?
So.
I'm reading across David on his monitor here. Okay. What's coming in on the Suicide Squad at Target?
Okay, Hunter Folk said, are you getting the Target Suicide Squad? Yes, I am. That is a, it's the Digibook. So it looks like an actual book.
Like those Superman ones you got with the movie on the back?
Yeah, and it has like the lenticular cover.
Yeah.
So Target's doing one for Suicide Squad. They're also, Best Buy's doing a Steelbook as well.
Oh.
All those are coming to me. I've already ordered them. So
let's take a raffle and see how many different ones David gets.
It's probably going to be about six. So
what's with Target and DC? I noticed
And Rovan Joseph, I'm sorry, I can't say your last name. But yeah, what's up, man? Yeah, he's a good subscriber there.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, so yeah, no problem. Anyway, so yeah, I think Best Buy is also doing a graphic novel.
Oh, really?
A graphic novel, Blu-ray combo set as well.
Okay.
So that one's coming as well. Hopefully, you know, early next week.
I still haven't seen that movie.
It's pretty good.
I still haven't.
It's not great, but it's fun. It's a fun movie.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So anyway, let's go ahead and move on from that. And we're going to be talking about something that just dropped actually a couple of days ago. Just out of the blue, they gave us a day's heads up on it, that it was going to be debuting on Jimmy Kimmel Live. And that is the trailer for Spider-Man Homecoming.
Man.
Spider-Man Homecoming, man. You know, I've been waiting for this one for a while. Obviously since before Civil War.
Yeah.
You know, when they announced that he was going to be in Civil War, I'd been waiting for this moment that he was going to have his own movie, you know, and we were going to see the whole story again. And I know everybody's question was like, well, is it going to be an origin story all over again? That kind of thing. Oh, it's going to suck because XYZ. Are they going to show Uncle Ben dying? I don't think so.
I don't think so.
I really hope not. But
I think we already know the story to that.
Exactly. So, okay, just without us going into it just yet, just overall as a whole, John, what did you think about the trailer?
That was cool in so many different ways because they showed so many things.
That's a good vague response. They did.
I mean, if you pay attention, like,
and it's true.
Really, really pay attention.
And it's true that they gave us so much, but they did it so fast in a short trailer, but I was just so happy. At the end of it,
even the teaser, we had the teaser up the day before, and just that, and it was almost like a get ready teaser. He was like, hey, what are you doing? Come on, man, we're waiting for you. And he's like, what? That first person,
Happy Hogan,
you know,
John Favreau,
and then they show him in his first Spider-Man suit, you know, the hoodie and everything.
So basically, this is taking place right before he goes off to fight in Civil War. Yeah, and I feel a lot of that's going to happen in the movie. I feel like they're going to be showing flashbacks here and there, you know, I guess, how he got there or how he got the suit and then him taking off and then coming back kind of thing, you know, and how his life was after that, you know. So I'm pretty excited for it.
I think it's crazy. It's a part that I didn't think they would show in the movie. I mean, how Tony Stark is telling him not to, you know.
Well, yeah. We'll get to that right now.
No.
We'll get to that.
Let's do this. God, man. Come on, man.
So the trailer starts out with him doing the typical superhero stuff. He comes across some robbers robbing an ATM, and these robbers each have Avengers masks.
I'll show you something real quick.
You know? And And it's funny because right off the bat, it's telling you this is part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Yeah. You know? It's like, you know, we're not going to not acknowledge what happened in Civil War. Check that out. Okay, so John's showing me something right now. And it's basically like a small meme. It says, when comics come to life. And basically, that scene that I'm talking about, that we're showing right there, is right here. I don't know if you can see it. Let's see if I can focus in on it as much as I can.
I dim down, but it's
and cool. And it shows the same scene, exactly. Yeah. You know? And I think, I want to say this happened in Ultimate Spider-Man.
Yes.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
But except one of them has a Batman mask on. Yeah. But anyway, so yeah, so each of them have like a Iron Man, a Hulk, Thor, and who else was it? It was one more other one. I can't remember.
Just saw it right now. Sorry.
But
Iron Man, Hulk, Thor, and Captain.
And Captain America, and they each have you know those masks on, and they kind of like look at them like oh, you know, and they get beat up, they get busted. But the thing that really like triggered to me or for me anyway was the fact that one of them had this blaster. You know, this blaster. Oh, they were like, you know, robbing the ATM, trying to bust it open. That blaster is not just like any sort of weapon that somebody that would have. You know, a goon
would have. Yeah.
The only thing that I can think of is that it could be like technology from the Chitauri. You know, when the invasion happened in the first Avengers movie?
Oh, and then people are just like black marketing.
Exactly. And people are grabbing certain weapons or certain things and changing them up, whatever, what have you. That was the first thing that I thought of anyway. And again, it's basically telling you this is part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
And you know what?
No doubt.
That would make sense. That would make so much sense if they added that in, because I mean, that could be a reason why, like, if, for instance, if they did put, like, the Shocker in, like, if he got one of the weapons from the Chitauri or something, he just modified it and he created something, and that would be cool, man. You know, it would explain, it would give more, a better background and detail into how this character became this because of help of
weaponry or from advanced whatever. Weaponry, and then now we have Tony Stark basically just talking to Spider-Man Peter Parker in the back of a vehicle. And he's basically telling me, like, well, what should I do? You know, he's like, well, you can't do this. You can't do that. You kind of are in this, like, gray area. That's where you're supposed to operate. Mm-hmm. And then one of the funniest moments, I thought, in the whole... I laughed out loud when I saw it, was Tony Stark reaches forward, and Peter Parker starts hugging him. He's like, I'm not trying to hug you. I'm trying to open the door for you to get out.
You know, dude, I had to, like, rewind that little bitty part because at first I thought he did go in for a hug.
Yeah, well, yeah, it looked like it.
And then
when he embraced him, he grabbed him.
No, opening the door for you to get out, you know?
And honestly, we kind of should have known better because the way he was, I guess, reacting to Peter Parker in Civil War, you know, where he was like, okay, kid, all right, get this web off. Let me go. You know, I got to go kind of thing. Or move your leg, I'm gonna sit down. That kind of thing. I should have known better, but it was just one of those moments. It threw me off, and I just like completely laughed out loud for it. So that was really good. And then we get a good look at the Vulture.
Man, dude.
I am so excited for the Vulture.
That looks cool.
And for him being played by Michael Keaton, by Michael Keaton, is just like stellar. Like, I'm like ready for it. Michael Keaton is amazing, dude.
Birdman.
Yeah, and then to top it off, I mean, look at the way he looks. Yeah. Like, he looks like a soldier.
Yeah. Oh, well,
like a Falcon.
Hey. Well, okay, Marvel Legends, they're coming out with the Build-A-Figure.
I saw it, and I didn't have time to put a thing, but it looked big.
It's big. Marvel Legends.
Is it a Build-A-Figure? Is that what it is?
Yeah, he's the BAF. Yeah,
he's the Build-A-Figure. Have to get that whole set.
Well, you get a better look at his outfit, and it's an Ace Flying jacket.
Yeah, that was the thing I was gonna. It was like a pilot's jacket, a pilot's jacket. And it looks, it was really cool because
it did
very subtly. It has like the thing around his neck, like the way he has in the comics.
In the comics,
you know what I mean? But he has the flight helmet and all that stuff. Yeah. Just awesome, dude. I love it.
Really looks cool.
I love every part of the Vulture, you know, as a whole, as you know, in this movie. Now I'm wondering what the Vulture would have looked like if they would have had a Spider-Man 4. Because Vulture was supposed to be the bad guy in Spider-Man 4. Mm-hmm. You know, I wonder if they would have gone something like that route, or something more comic oriented.
Vulture's power is to extract the youth, right?
Well, I think that they did that on the cartoon.
In the cartoon?
Yeah, I
so
think
then that, what, he's just a cranky old man?
Yeah, with wings.
So terrorize everybody. Wait till somebody dies and go eat them. Just
pecking somebody. So man, I'm so excited. I was really excited to see that. You know, that we got an actual first look.
Yeah.
You know, at the Vulture. I was like, awesome. I am sold right there. And then one thing I guess was kind of surprising, but kind of cool as well, was that we got a point where Spider-Man was kind of like, you know, saying, it's like, man, well, you know what? Why is he treating me like a kid?
Yeah.
You know, I guess I'm going to have to prove myself. And then he does like this backflip over a helicopter. Yeah. And shows off that he has like those, the wings that he used to have underneath his arm, you know, back in the day.
Back in the day, man.
But, but I think in this case, they're actually going to be used for a purpose. You know, it looks like it's going to help him glide.
Yeah.
Or something.
I mean, you know, look what he's facing.
Yeah, exactly. So I think that's pretty cool. And obviously, I'm going to assume that Tony Stark had something to do with that as well. You know, because we didn't see that in Civil War, so it has to be like some sort of upgrade. You know, that he's getting from Tony. So, I'm pretty super pumped about that as well. So, it's funny because that happened, and, like, a day before, you know, my son had, like, pajama day at school, right?
Yeah.
And it just so happened that he wanted to buy this Spider-Man onesie, you know?
Yeah.
It was, like, a big one. I was like, are you serious? He's like, I want it. I was like, okay. So, it was a full costume Spider-Man, and he lifted up his arms, and it had the things underneath.
Really?
And he was like, what are these? I'm like, let me school you, kid. So I had to give him some backstory.
Yeah.
And then he saw the trailer. He was like, oh, my God. It's just like my costume. I was like, calm down. It's not a costume. It's pajamas.
PJs, buddy.
But, yeah, so I thought that was kind of cool as well. And they're thinking ahead with this kind of thing. You know what I mean? So, so I was really excited for that as well. It looks really cool. The next thing is interesting, and I want to hear your take. I have a small little theory, okay, and I want to hear your take on it. All right, we see this guy. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a guy holding a gun, like a blaster.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at the blaster, the front of it, it almost looks like a hand.
Okay. It
almost looks like an Iron Man hand.
What?
With, like, the repulsor blaster in the middle. Almost. Okay. Maybe not exactly.
Yeah.
Resembles it in a way.
Okay.
You have this guy here holding the gun, Donald Glover here. I can't remember this guy, but he looks like Tom Hardy.
No, but his jacket looks like...
But it, yeah, hear me out. All right, Donald Glover here is on the side. All right? I knew Donald Glover was going to be in it. Do you know who Donald Glover is?
No.
He's like a comedic actor.
Okay.
But he's a rapper also on the side, right?
Yes.
And, he, in the past, had petitioned to be Miles Morales when they were rebooting Spider-Man.
Yeah, that's him.
Okay, and then he was actually the voice of Miles Morales in the Spider-Man cartoon.
Really?
Yeah. So, when they casted him in here, they were like, what is he? Like, who is he related? Maybe somewhat related to Miles Morales? But anyway, so... All right, so that picture here, all
right? You need to hurry up, man, because I'm happy right now.
I know. Well, just hear me out. I have this weird... Again, thing. Nothing shocking is the Knights of Ren, the Knights of Ren. But all right, so then we have this picture here.
Was it shocking?
This is this picture of another guy. He has like this blaster thing on his arm as well. But if you notice, he has the same yellow sleeves, right? All right. This guy's name, I can't remember the actor's name. His last name is Woodbine, I believe. But anyway, I have this like weird inkling that both of these guys are part of a gang.
Goons.
And they are testing out this technology. This shocker technology.
All right.
You know? And, you know, say these guys are going to be, you know, the goons, like you said. They're going to be running amok. And Spider-Man's gonna stop him, only to reveal that Donald Glover back here is the real shocker.
That's a shock.
That's a shock. That's a
shock. I didn't think about that.
I think that guy in the back is the mastermind. He's the leader guy.
He's going to be playing like what Joker did to the bank robbers. Basically. He's just going to be playing stupid. And then basically, at the end.
Something to that degree anyway. Mm-hmm. I think that's what's going to happen.
That makes sense.
And yeah, like, when I started thinking about it, I was like, oh my God, that'd be kind of cool, you know?
Yeah.
At least give him a role that, you know, we wouldn't expect him in.
And it makes sense, because if you guys remember on Civil War, Tony Stark did have a repulsor blast, but it was like a shockwave blast, remember?
Yeah, he pulled out for his palm.
And it was hurting Winter Soldier.
Yeah.
Trying to subdue him and everything.
So, I mean, I don't know if maybe they got a hold of some Stark tech.
Yeah.
You know, along with the Chitauri stuff. The other thing, though, is that there's a character in there called the Tinkerer.
Ooh, I've heard of that.
And he's supposed to be in the movie as well.
Uh-huh.
And, I mean, it's kind of self-explanatory what he does. He tinkers with you know, gadgets and things like that. So I think he's going to be helping the Shocker gang. Okay, just first off. You know, did Stan Lee... Well, Stan Lee wouldn't have known where that name would have gone over the years.
Yeah.
But now it's become a thing, and it's like... I feel kind of weird saying Shocker. The Shocker gang, it's a gang full of people that go run around.
Shock you.
Anyway, so yeah. So, I mean, do you think that that's a pretty good theory right there?
That's pretty cool. I think I like that. I started to think maybe, you know what, this may be just like a real quick, excuse me. This may be, you know, okay, when the movie starts out, Dave was mentioning, I think it's gonna point us in that direction where I guess like things are already happening, you know.
Yeah.
Like it's past, you basically, know, Civil War.
Like, yeah, like you're gonna hit the ground running. Type
yeah,
of thing. Yeah.
So this may be, I think this may be like a real quick sweep up for him, like something like to fight, or like he's gonna come across these guys in the very beginning of the movie, take them all out, but then there's like this, or what if like this continues throughout the movie, like all these. Because remember,
all
Tony,
these like Shocker gang guys,
yes,
coming out of nowhere.
Because Tony says, look, man, I know you want to do something. Chill. Just don't leave it to us.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it. Like, maybe all these things keep happening, and he wants to do something, and it's this gang. You know, it's just so many different things are going on. I just have a feeling that in the beginning he'll run into them in the beginning.
Like, actually, yeah, exactly. I think that would be great. If, like, little by little, we see one guy with, like, you know, a piece of tech where it's kind of like the Shocker gear. And then the next guy has something just like that, but a little bit more improved, and so on and so on, you know?
You know what it reminds me of? The Batman games. How the goons take after...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Take after the actual main villain. That's what it seems like. And actually, there was an Amazing Spider-Man 2 game, I think it was.
Uh-huh.
On PlayStation 3, I played a good while back, probably about a year or two, but maybe 2 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And actually, Shocker looks... almost exactly to the pictures that have been shown,
yeah,
of, you know, what he looks like in this movie. So it's kind of clear that they're taking, you know, inspiration from somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, and just like you were saying, that a lot of the goons kind of pick up little things like that until you get to the villain, you're like, oh, okay, then that's like everything put together on that villain. So yeah, that's kind of cool though. I'm hoping that I'm right, because that would be really neat. I think that'd be a great storyline to have in the movie.
That's pretty cool. I like that.
And then the other thing that we have here is a picture of him basically holding like a ship together.
That's crazy, man.
And it reminded me, obviously, right off the bat, Spider-Man 2. When Tobey Maguire was holding the train, you know? And it's very reminiscent of that. And I'm kind of glad that they put something like that in, because it shows his strength.
Yeah.
You know, even as a, 16-year-old, I think he's supposed to be. As a 16-year-old, he has this immense strength to hold a damn ship together. Yeah, that's pretty cool. As long as he doesn't do the same face that Tobey Maguire made. Do it again. Yeah. So, man, I don't know, man. And I'm just really excited. I'm really excited about the movie. I think everything about it that they've shown so far is very promising.
Heck yeah.
And it has the feel of, like, you know, they kept saying that, you know, oh, it's going to be like the Breakfast Club type of thing. And it kind of has that feel to it. Like, very teeny bopper type of movie, but yet with this superhero overcast story, you know what I mean?
The one thing that I thought was pretty cool, and I mean, I don't know, you might look at it as maybe it didn't have to be in there. I think it did, because I never really thought about it in all the other movies, and we've had how many? 5 of them?
Yeah. Yep.
It's Peter Parker gets caught by his friend crawling on the ceiling. And then his friend's like, it looked like he had the Death Star Legos.
Oh, yeah, he
drops it. You know? And he's like, you're Spider-Man. He's like, nah, man. And if you notice what he did, he touched that spider on
his
chest.
And it just fell.
And it fell off.
I like that, though.
Yeah, because...
you don't see him, like, pulling on the tights and all that stuff.
Like, how does he get in that damn thing so much? You know, and it's just like, you know, he's like, nah, what are you talking about? And then they show him all ripped and everything, a little 16-year-old.
They had to do that, man. They always have the Spider-Man ab shot, you know, kind of thing to show that Spider-Man's like this fit person, you know. And there was a lot of like little Easter eggs put in there. There's a point where he's in the classroom during the trailer, and above the board, they have like the I guess famous scientists. The very last picture is Bruce Banner.
Oh, is it?
Yeah,
I didn't see that.
And then there's a point where he's walking in the hallway. And there's like this mural on the wall, I guess, of inventors and things like that. And one of the photos on there, or one of the, you know, paintings on the mural is Tony Stark's dad. So, they're very, you know, pretty much very, very much basically telling you that this is a part of the Avengers universe, part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Yeah.
You know, there's no doubt about it. So, I thought that was kind of neat that they threw in little things like that throughout the trailer. It was just a trailer, and they gave us that much stuff. That's, you know,
awesome,
what I mean?
Man.
I think they know that people are waiting for this stuff.
Hell yeah!
And they had the big old Marvel Studios logo right in the beginning, too. So I was like, all right.
What did you think about when they showed Michael Keaton in the bus and he was telling him, technically, just to fuck off?
Michael Keaton, dude. I mean, again, I'm excited for him to be in the movie, because he brings like this depth, man, as an actor. And he can literally, like, he can just take it serious. Like, he can go serious mode and just flip the movie into something else so quickly.
Like when he was a Batman, what did he say? He goes, what does he tell Joker? Because if you want to get crazy, man, let's get crazy, man.
Yeah. Or Mr. Mom, when, you know. One of my favorite Michael Keaton movies, though, is Duplicity.
Multiplicity. Yeah.
I love it so much, anyway.
You know what? Man, he had to say that. I've seen him. I went to David's house back then. I go there, I'm like, what do you want? I'm watching Multiplicity. Come in.
Get a chair.
It's like, I was sitting there. The movie sucks, like, man.
Nah, I'm good. I'm like, what are you? He's like, nah, I'm good. I'm going to take off. You just got here. Anyway,
can't believe you like that movie, man.
I do. I love it. Anyway, so the trailer ends very blatantly with Iron Man and Spider-Man,
man,
you know,
so
going through
cool.
the city. And it's July 7th, 2017, that it's going to come out. Honestly, that's really not that far away.
No.
You know, when you start thinking about it.
7/17.
Yeah, and then was it 2 months before that, we're getting Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2?
Hell yeah.
You know, and then I think later on in the year, Thor Ragnarok.
Yeah.
It's like, shit, man. 2017 is going to be a good year for superhero movies.
Yes, it is. It
really is. So anyway, so we're going to go ahead and move on from that. And we're going to talk a little bit about Resident Evil 7. They just released, I don't say just released, but it was like, I think I want to say a little bit after Thanksgiving, they released an update for the demo that they have. They called it the Midnight Demo. The second one was the Twilight one, and then first one was just a demo. So during the Twilight demo, you know, it opened up a little bit. If you guys don't know, you know, the demo for Resident Evil 7 basically just takes place in a house. You know, you only have a certain amount of places you can go. A lot of stuff's blocked off because it's just a demo.
Yeah.
You know, they're just trying to show you how the game's going to be. And actually, the demo is just much like PT was supposed to be. it's not going to be in the game at all.
Okay.
It's just giving you an idea what it's supposed to be like.
Yeah.
But anyway, so the Twilight demo opened up, like, I think some stairs to, like, an attic or something like that.
Yeah.
Gave you a couple of different places to locate. And then this one, you know, gave you... there was in the demo, there's a door, and it looks like a moldy door. This looks like old, like kind of, you know, decrepit.
Okay.
You know, and in the Twilight demo, in the second demo, you couldn't go through it. It was blocked off. This one opens up that door.
Oh shit!
And you go through it, and you see like this dark hallway and stuff like that, and you know it leads. I love these games, but they raise my blood pressure up so much, you know, that I get like, so I can get kind of scared easily. I mean, if you go and look at the video for the second demo, I'm just like, no. Like, anyway, so it opens that door. It leads down a hallway. There's a bathroom with a bathtub, like just pouring blood.
Really?
And there's a bicycle in it. Like, I guess that like they kidnapped somebody and murdered them in the bathtub, kind of thing. Yeah,
with the bike.
Yeah, they just threw the bike in there. They just throw everything in there.
It's all personal items. Melt them down.
So it opens that up, and I'm like, okay. And then it has like an area in the pipes where it's like, oh, well, you need a, you know, something to open it. All right. So you keep going down the hallway, and it leads you to this like gated, you know, this door with a gate, and it's like a lock and key type of thing.
Yeah.
And you go down it, and it leads you also to a room with a bunch of body bags just hanging, you know,
like in Resident Evil 4.
Basically, it felt a lot like that. It really did, but from a first person view, you know. And then from there, you know, you're searching around, whatever. I'm already like on edge, like, what the fuck is gonna happen? It's like one of these things is gonna open up or something, right?
Yeah.
And you go up to one of them, and you can actually kick it, and it swings. It goes, oof! You know, it swings, right?
It.
No, you no, say no, oof, no. Or yeah, the guy, like the character,
the body. Ow. Hey, hold on. Let me ask you this, because I don't know this, and I haven't played it yet or anything like that, but has anything come out yet? Like has a monster come out, or...
It's funny you say that, John. Well,
because I'm just saying, because, like, is it going...
It's funny you say that.
Okay.
Because, again, like I said, I was already on edge, yeah. Right? And there's only one way you can go. There's, like, a back room type of thing. And you go in there, and I'm, like, very careful. I'm examining everything. I'm at the doorway, and I'm, like... Looking around, like, okay, what's in there, kind of thing, right?
Excuse me.
God. And I see a baby, there's like a doll on a shelf. Uh-huh. So I'm like, okay, it's in my view, so I'm assuming that I have to go get it.
Yeah. Right? If I go over there, get it real quick, and run back.
It's exactly what I tried to do. I was like, all right, I know how to run, so I'm going to hurry up and run
grab
over
it
there.
Grab it and run.
And so I run over there, and all of a sudden I hear, boom, like a big old crash. I'm like, oh my god! Turn around, and it's this creature coming at me.
Wait. Oh my god!
Oh my god! That's my exact reaction.
All right, go ahead. Let me see.
And there's this creature coming out of it. Came out of one of the walls.
The fuck is that?
And it reminds me a lot of the regenerators. Remember?
Yeah.
Regenerators and the ones that had spikes.
Yeah, those are the regenerators too.
Well, there's two different kinds. I guess they're similar.
There was
one was in Resident Evil Revelations, that was
you're talking about that, because there's a couple of them. Remember, there's one with the clamps, and then there's one with the worm. You had to kill the worm.
Well, it reminds me a lot of that.
Okay.
Or like, and something out of the thing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
That looks pretty cool.
So it's coming out. It's coming out at me, and I'm like, oh shit! So I'm like, at that moment, I'm like, what do I do? Do I go for the doll? Do I go back? I went for the doll. There was a key there.
Excuse me. Yeah.
So I grabbed the key. I didn't have to grab the
doll.
Killed
you with the key?
No, and actually at that point I had like a hatchet. And I was trying to like whack it with that. Didn't work. So I ran away. And then I tried to go out. I was just like, fuck this shit. I'm going to leave, right? Go out the door. It's blocked.
Oh.
The door was blocked, right? I like push it open. And you see like there's something in front of it. and it opens a little bit, and you see that old man in the doorway, and he's laughing. I'm like, son of a bitch.
So, I just threw my hatchet at him.
So I circle around, and I remember, I'm like, I can kick the body bag that's there. So the thing was coming at me, and I kicked the body bag and knocked it down.
Oh.
Yeah. So I knocked it down, went to the door again, and apparently it said, like, to press X. So I pressed it, and it kicked the door open just a little bit more. It didn't let me out. It's like, damn it. I see what you're doing here now.
He gave me a little hope, and yeah. It took it from me.
So I'm like, I see what you're doing here now. So I ran around again. And then went back to the door.
Knock his ass over again.
And I hit, yeah, I did that. And I hit the door again, and finally busted open. I booked it. I was like, screw this. I ran up the stairs to the gated door. Mm-hmm. I was like, bam, closed it behind myself.
Okay, but up until this point, has anything else popped out in the
that's
game?
That's it, no. That's the only thing so far.
So two demos? Two,
yeah.
Three? Okay, so two demos. You go through this damn thing, and I've seen David's video. It seems like there was a lot of suspense, and that's what I wanted to know. But I guess I asked it right at the perfect time when something did pop out. But apparently, so nothing does come out in those demos, so it does have you on edge. You
know, yeah, like it does exactly. And I think they were waiting for this last demo. This last update for the demo to reveal a creature.
Another question. When you get this update and you start, do you start off in your old save point? Or do you start off like...
No, it's all over again.
All over again? Okay.
Yeah. So you have to basically do everything again, you know what I mean, what you did. But at this point, you know, you kind of already know where to go, navigate. So you kind of run through everything real quick. Then you go through the open spot, the new spot.
Yeah.
And you go from there. Now, there's two endings. To this update.
Okay.
All right. There's
ending. So that's it. There's no more updates for this.
That's it. This is the last update. Okay. And then they're gonna wait until the game comes out in January. It's right around the corner, man. I can't wait. It's gonna be amazing.
You know what, dude? I need to get on these demos, man. I have never played.
And so there's two endings. Like I said, there's an infected ending, and then there's a true ending. Is what they call it.
Yeah.
The infected ending is, if you get hit by that monster, which I did, as you leave, you're heading down that hallway trying to go back to where you were. You know, he's about to open the door, and his hands start shaking, and it starts turning black.
Oh, shit.
Right?
Yeah.
And throughout right? Ash versus Evil Dead style. And so, anyway. So, you know, he starts becoming infected. And throughout the rest of your time there, you can kind of hear him go, like labored breath and stuff like that, and hurting. And then you go back up to the attic. There's a point where you find an attic key. And you go back up to the attic. And I can't remember if I mentioned it before, that in the attic, there's a ladder that leads up to a window.
The second, remember when we made fun of that?
Yeah.
The second attic.
That's what it was, the second. We were like, oh yeah, there's a second attic.
Stupid.
Yeah. So there's a window up there, and there's a ladder up to the window, and you start going up there with the attic key. So you're like, oh, okay, cool. You know, I can get out. Start going up there. Right before you go up there, he starts and he falls down.
Infected.
And he's infected, Andy.
You died. Stupid.
But yeah. No. And then as he's like hurting, whatever, in pain, probably about to die or turn into whatever, the old man comes up and he says how stupid he is or something like that.
Told you.
And then he does the thing where he puts the hand towards the camera and goes black.
Goes black, right? Yeah.
And then the true ending is you get up to the set and you unlock it and you leave. Right? But it fades, and then there's like, you know, a story.
He trips
and
it off, says, no.
He fell out of the window, broke his neck. And then there's a little story that says that he got out, the cops arrived, and found, he started making all these claims about what was going on in the house. They didn't find any videotape, they didn't find anything, but that they looked it over because he had a little bit of LSD on him.
What?
Yeah. So like, okay. I do think, hey, MaliceDaw79, what's up, man? That dude's a awesome YouTuber. I love his stuff. But anyway, He wants to know our thoughts on Resident Evil 7. Will it be good? I think it's going to be great. I think it's a different spin on the genre.
Yeah.
But yet, it feels like it's going back. It felt, honestly, it felt a lot like Resident Evil 1.
Well, that's what they're claiming.
Yeah. Like,
they're claiming that that's what they want to do with
it. You know, it felt back. It felt a lot like Resident Evil 1, but obviously from the first-person perspective, so that changes things a lot.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think the guys over at Capcom learned a lot from PT and how a first-person perspective on a horror game, like a straight up horror game,
yeah,
you know, can change the playing field.
Now,
you know what I mean?
This guy that you're playing in the game, is this going to be the character we're going to be playing in the new Resident Evil game?
I don't know. Okay. I don't think so.
So the true ending,
a different guy.
They bust his ass because the dude's popping drugs, right? You know, he's slamming
pills.
He's slamming drugs. he's shooting up drugs. Oh, anyways, he's in jail. So at one point in the game, you end up in jail, and then you meet this man.
That'd be interesting.
You know what I mean?
That would be interesting if that character came back. You know,
like you're in jail, and you're like, officer, you gotta listen to me and listen. And they don't listen. And you go, and like somebody behind you, you hear a voice like, you know, I believe you. And you turn around.
It's Michael Jordan.
And like Space Jam.
So random.
Michael Jordan.
I don't know.
Hey, anyone play some basketball? What do you call it? No.
God. The Space Jam song starts. It's your chance. Do your dance. In the Space Jam.
So, no, like, okay.
But so, anyway, so yeah.
The dude's in there and he's just like, you know, I believe you or something. And then you, and you talk a little bit or whatever. And then he just goes, you know, or then he gets affected.
Yeah, no, I think that would be really cool if at some point, anyway. I know a lot of the game, from what I understand, is supposed to take place in the house, and the way that they make the house look, it looks like it's like a farmhouse, right? Yeah. But it's apparently a whole lot bigger than what we think it is.
What you've only
it's you basically know. like the way the mansion is.
Yeah,
you know. So no,
that's true.
Because Miles was asking if it's a reboot. No, as far as I know, it's not a reboot. They're still, you know, taking in consideration the previous events. You know, I don't know. See, and this is what kind of gets me. I guess we have to play the game to really get the whole story.
Yeah.
Because, you know, something like this with the whole Raccoon City event that happened.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you would think that it would have gotten out to everybody, and people would know about this. I mean, Raccoon City got annihilated.
Yeah, and you know? You can't call it a reboot when it says 7, you know?
Yeah, and
also, if it would have been a reboot, then
they would have just called it Resident Evil.
Yeah.
Probably.
Or Biohazard, but they would really, really push that it was a reboot.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because everybody loved number one.
And he's asking again, Malastal 79, did we play the VR experience, the kitchen on RE7? I didn't get to play the kitchen. I've heard a lot about it. Honestly, I've never even played PlayStation VR.
Didn't we cover the kitchen?
We talked about it.
Yeah, we did.
We did. But I, again, with the way that the game is going, just the demo itself, again, it had me on edge, dude, like hardcore.
Yeah.
I can only imagine on PlayStation VR. I would love to experience it on PlayStation VR, and I think it's going to be amazing.
I think we even talked about that too. It is going to be amazing. It's going to be awesome.
Because basically what you're going to be doing is, like, I don't want to say sensory deprivation, but you know, you're going to have headphones on. You're just going to be in it.
It's going to be,
you know what I mean?
To me, I think it will never get boring, because no matter how many times you're like, what is that? And when you turn, they can do it to the point where right when you turn, boom, you know?
Yeah.
And every time, I think, that'll get you. That has to get you. Something loud.
And they only allow a certain perspective.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So even like, there was moments where I was opening doors, you'd see the guy's hand push on the door, but everything would kind of black out on the side. So I'm like, something could pop out from out of nowhere, and it would scare the shit out of me.
When that happened, did it like the
kind of
did it okay
kind of
like to make you think maybe something can happen?
The music gets, you know, hyped up.
That's what I'm saying.
And then you also there's certain things, man. Again, I can only imagine on PlayStation VR when you have headphones on, you know, straight up like in your ear, you can hear everything. I was just playing it on a TV, and you could hear rumblings like people were upstairs type of thing, or like, you know, in another room knocking something over or growling kind of thing. So I think it's going to be cool, man. I'm really looking forward to it, like, a lot. Did they say the whole game is not? As far as I know, the whole game is going to be like PlayStation VR. You know, it's going to be... This is what I understand, is that Resident Evil 7 is going to come out, and they're going to have a PlayStation VR option on the game itself. So I thought that was really cool.
Or do they just come out with the regular one, and then he like, here's the...
Well, see, that's what I thought.
The special edition one that comes with the regular and the VR.
Well, see, that's what I thought they were going to do, was that they were going to have a PlayStation VR version and then a regular version.
Yeah.
Apparently, they're just releasing the game, and it has a PlayStation VR option in it.
Okay, cool.
So that's really cool. They are releasing a special edition, though, like a collector's edition that...
Comes with a little bit of LSD. It's
a,
hot...
a little bit of LSD in it.
Everybody gets busted. You go to jail.
It's a house.
Okay. Oh, yeah. I've seen it.
It's a house, and it's basically like a music box.
Really?
And it plays... Okay, when I say music box, you would think, ding, 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 ding. You know, like, it would just play like the regular... It plays a fucking song. You
know? Oh, it plays the music?
It plays an actual song.
Oh, shit.
And you see, like, the windows light up.
Oh, cool.
Like, lights go off and on in the windows. And then when the song ends, you see a shadow in one of the windows.
Oh, cool.
I was like, oh, my God, that's awesome. Yeah, I was like, look at away, but that's cool. And it comes with a steel bookcase for the... It comes with a steel bookcase for the game and stuff like that. But it is going to be retailing at, I believe it's $180.
Jesus Christ.
That's pretty pricey.
For a music box, man. Yeah.
So I'm actually considering myself, you know, like, pre-ordering it.
What's his name?
Malisdoll 79 says he's going to pre-order that house.
Okay, Malisdoll 79. I was just about to say, how about you buy it and then you tell us? And then, you know, that'd be awesome, man.
I might want to get it, though. I really might want to get it. I'm considering it.
You want the fucking...
I want everything.
Well, he wants the steelbook. That's what it is.
I mean, that house looks really cool.
Resident Evil 4 started the steelbook. Do you just have yours?
No, I don't.
I have one.
You do you really?
I still have mine.
Oh, that's awesome, dude.
And you know what sucks is it has a little rust here and there on it.
On the hinges, maybe?
No, like on the cuff. Yeah. I mean, man, I didn't have, like, the good, you know, place to put it and everything, but I do now.
Yeah. So, anyway, Resident Evil 7, it looks like it's shaping up to be an awesome game, dude. I think it's again, like I said, going back to the roots of what Resident Evil was, but yet taking a different spin on it, making it feel like, you know, okay.
And keeping it dark, man.
Yeah.
Because we don't, you know.
With PT, when PT got canceled, it broke my heart, dude. It really did. Honestly, I'm not going to. I'm still with it.
But he's like, you know, you don't understand.
It broke
guys.
My heart. Viewers, you know, out there? I was so bummed. And I feel like, you know, people learned from that, though.
Hell yeah.
You know, a lot of developers learned from that. And I think it was kind of, it was almost like a blessing, you know? Because we get these other properties that learn from that incident.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I don't think if PT wouldn't have happened, then we wouldn't have this Resident Evil 7.
Yeah,
you know.
And you know what? And that's just them listening to us, because everybody, you know, everybody has a voice and everybody used it. They really liked the shit out of PT.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
So, you know,
we did it. We did it, guys. Next up, we're gonna talk a little bit about some more gaming stuff, actually.
All right.
This is a very gaming heavy episode.
And it should be.
And we haven't done one of these like this in a very long time.
I know.
You know, but this is kind of like, I guess, our roots. You know, I mean, this is the stuff we love too. We love comics. We love everything else. You know, but gaming is also a big part of us.
Oh yeah.
Is Death Stranding? They released a second trailer for Death Stranding over at the PlayStation Experience 2016. And it was, I mean, was it PlayStation Experience 2016?
Yeah, it was.
No, I'm sorry. You know what? I think it was the Game Awards.
Well, that's right, because that's when Hideo came back.
Yeah, it was the Game Awards. And they released a second trailer for it. And it was very interesting. Just much like the first trailer, gave us a lot of awesome visuals. Didn't give us much as far as story goes. You know, Kojima is very good at keeping people guessing. You know what I mean? He's a genius that way. And he's a mastermind that way. But it kills me every time he comes out with a project, Metal Gear or whatever it was, yeah. even throughout the years. He just gives you little bits at a time. And he
drags you.
And it's cool because for somebody like me that likes to theorize, theorize about things, you know, it's cool because...
Hold on. It's what? Not theorizing, Dave. It's David having the Spider-Man costume on with the wings. Just shitting all over everybody.
No. I love to try to piece things together. I love like riddles or puzzles and things like that. Especially when it comes to stuff like this.
Yeah.
It's amazing. And people that put the thought into it, that take the time to leave these little clues. Leave these little clues here and there about things. The trailer begins with Guillermo del Toro.
Stupid, bro.
Which was a big shocker to me. I was like, what? What am I looking at? Is he in the game? So, it's Guillermo del Toro, and it looks like Guillermo del Toro. It's a very good interpretation of Guillermo del Toro.
He go like, I am back.
And I thought that... I thought it was really cool because Guillermo del Toro is a huge supporter of Kojima.
Yeah.
He's had Kojima's back this entire way with Konami and the Silent Hills thing.
Yeah.
And basically, with Kojima being Kojima, he was very, you know, with all that happening... He was very much like, you know, very respectful, didn't want to talk about it. Guillermo del Toro, on the other hand, they would ask him about what happened, and he was very blunt, mind you. And he would just say, Konami fucked up.
God damn,
no,
bro.
I'm serious.
I didn't know that.
Like, they're fucking stupid. Like, kind of thing, you know what I mean? And he was very blunt about it. He was very mad about it.
Damn.
He made it very vocal.
Well, I mean, come you on. Know, I mean, like, I mean, the dude's probably really passionate about like about games and, or like or what about that project, and for somebody to drop the bomb,
yeah,
the
bomb,
you know, come on, man.
But he's a very big supporter of Kojima.
Hi, Nathan.
And you know, so it was kind of like, okay, he put his buddy in his game. You know what I mean? He wanted to work with him in some capacity anyway. So he put him in the game or in the trailer anyway. And then it, you know, you see Guillermo del Toro. He kind of backs up, and you see that he has his baby with him in this container, right? Very reminiscent of Norman Reedus when he had the baby.
Yeah.
You know, with the, I guess, electronic umbilical cord, or I guess whatever you call it. So that was very interesting, and it looked very much like a war zone, like almost like World War One inspired.
Oh, on the beach.
No.
You said one?
No, you know, I'll say World War II. They showed him kind of like in this like, I guess, ditch type of thing. And they showed like a brick bridge, you know, with a tunnel going through it underneath. You know, it's very war inspired, it felt like. And he kind of, you know, walks up over there and puts his back to the bridge. And then they kind of pan up. And they show this tank going down the bridge. Now, it's funny because it's not just a normal tank. It almost looks like it's like a tank, but with this organic stuff coming out of it. Like tentacles and like skeletons and things like that. You know, it's kind of weird. And obviously with the oil stuff coming out of it as well. You know, it's strange. It's a strange thing. And they show troops, you know, following the tank as well, and they're all skeleton troops.
I know what this is.
Yeah.
I figured it out.
What?
It's, what's that one movie where, oh God, what is it? The one where they, when they see you and they, they do the little scream, the others are
weird. I just thought about that the other day. No, it was,
Sea People?
The Puppet Masters.
Okay.
Or like Invasion of the Body Snatchers type of thing.
There you go. Okay, Invasion of the Body Snatchers and War of the Worlds put together.
That's what it seems like, kind of.
Alien-esque.
Yeah, it seems very similar. That's actually a good comparison.
It's weird, man.
And so they show these troops, that, I mean, full army gear, and they're skeletons.
It's like a Giger tank.
Very much so. It feels very much like that style, too. Pretty cool. And then they show Guillermo del Toro, you know, like holding the baby again. No, he has like this fear, this look of fear on his face. And he connects the baby to I guess, he connects the pod to a cord that I guess is coming out of him.
Yeah.
I don't know. And then they pan down, and the water, I guess it's water or oil, starts kind of rising, you know, to his feet, and starts rising. And then you see it, like a baby doll, like kind of floating towards him. And one eye is like flickering. It's weird. And again, all this imagery, it's like an imagery overload, dude. Yeah. Because I don't know, I can't, I've seen it a couple times already, and I can't really perceive what's going on. But it was funny because I saw the baby doll, and I noticed something.
Uh-oh.
That it had the same scarring, like the same cut.
And Norman?
As Norman Reedus on the stomach.
Uh-huh.
And obviously that's where the umbilical cord goes. Like, is this like, do they escape by cutting themselves off from the source? I don't know. That's what I'm thinking.
Maybe there's something there attached and they get rid of it
inside, and they have in order to break themselves free of whatever, they have to cut themselves open.
Maybe that's why he woke up.
Yeah.
He probably
exactly.
Yeah, David.
Like you're coming out of the Matrix, dude. You know?
I'll throw some jelly and shit.
So yeah, so I thought that was an interesting thing, you know what I mean? And then so Guillermo del Toro, you know, again, I don't know if he's a character, I don't know if he's what, but he starts making his way into the tunnel underneath the bridge. Dark tunnel. They show him going in, and then they kind of pan the camera into the tunnel, right? Mm-hmm. And then they show a bunch of troops waiting at the end.
Skeleton troops.
Skeleton troops. As you can see, there's
oh, yeah, huh.
Skeleton faces, and then a guy in the middle, like an actual guy, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, person.
And I thought that was, again, that was interesting as well, because I'm like, who are these guys? Like, what are they doing? What are they? A lot of them, the skeleton troops, the skeleton guys on the side, look very much like World War II gear.
You know, Knights of Ren.
Right, Knights of Ren. They had World War II gear on, like old school military stuff on.
Yeah.
The guy in the middle was basically like Modern Warfare. Guy, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He has like the, you know, the goggles and all that shit. And so yeah, I thought that was really interesting. And then they zoom up to the guy in the middle, because obviously the guy in the middle is the boss.
Yeah,
you know,
he's running shit.
And he's leading. He kind of does this number with his hand, like tells him to go, and cords come off of the guys, off of the troops, and then they start heading down the hallway. Down the tunnel, right? The cords come in and go into like a pack that he has, and they zoom in on the guy, and it's this guy, Mads Mikkelsen. He played Hannibal on the TV show Hannibal. And he's in Doctor Strange
recently. Is that the guy that was on the 007 movie?
You know what?
I was crying, and
I want to say that he was. I think he was in the. Yeah,
I can't stand that guy.
But he's in this game. Apparently, Kojima's a huge fan of his.
Really?
So that's why he's like, he requested him. Like, I want us to work together.
That guy. I think he, whatever role he, even if he's a good guy in a movie, if he's a dad, and his son was like, you know, I don't know, in a soccer or something. Like that, yeah. He just has this look like. He can just be a bad guy.
Yeah, no.
And just being like soccer dad, you know?
No, he could be like shopping for groceries in the store. You'd be like, oh, you're doing something evil.
Yeah.
What are you plotting?
Come here. Where are the olives? You know, it's just...
Where are the corn pops?
And then... And like, their blood.
Sorry. So, I mean, so, yeah, so they picked him as... I don't know if he's the main villain, but he's a villain in this story. Mm-hmm. And I liked him. I liked him in Doctor Strange. I thought he was a good villain in there.
I still haven't seen Doctor Strange.
It's a great movie. Anyway, so yeah. I mean, that's kind of what it is right there. It just kind of stopped right there. And it's like, I want to be like super impressed, like super pumped about it, like it was a Spider-Man trailer.
Wait a minute.
But it's like, I love it. Don't get me wrong. I will be day one, like, wanting to buy this game.
It just ended?
Yeah, that's
like,
it.
They Del Toro didn't go, you fucked up Konami. You know, just like at the end. And then,
look for Hellboy 3. No, no, no. It just ended. It just ended right there. And that's kind of all we got. It was, again, visually awesome. You know, but didn't give too much information as far as story, and it's for a reason.
Yeah.
He wants to be very secretive, and it's probably going to be, you know, a good ways off before we see the game coming out. But it's funny, because I was talking about this the other day. I got this alert on my phone that, IGN, breaking news, IGN official announcement with Hideo Kojima. I was like, what's going on? Like, what happened? You know, I was like, don't tell me this game got canceled too.
Oh, man.
Right? So I was like, oh my God, okay. Let me check it out. And it's this video package of Hideo Kojima talking about, you know, how he's been on this journey, you know, since leaving. I don't even think they mentioned Konami. He's damn. Like, since, you know, since what happened.
The departure.
And he was like, it's been a journey. And, you know, I've been traveling around trying to find the right people to work with. For many years already, and you know, finally, you know, we decided that we're going to be using the game engine from Guerrilla Games, and I was like, okay,
yeah,
like, I mean, it's a big deal. It is, because obviously he can't use the Fox engine anymore, yeah. You know, and building an engine from scratch, a game engine from scratch, would take years, and we probably wouldn't see, you know, this game until like probably 5 years from now.
Yeah.
6 years from now, if that was the case. So he has to find a studio to work with, you know, to use their game engine. And he used the game engine for that Horizon Zero Dawn, I think it is. It's like a game that's like hunting. They have dinosaurs in it, I think, and like this prehistoric wildlife, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Amazing open world type of, you know, game. And I think that's kind of what he was looking for.
Mm-hmm.
Like an open world type of game engine. And he was started talking about it. And it was an interesting interview, I'm not going to lie, a little interesting video. But, you know, it ended, and I'm like, okay, this was kind of like the equivalent of a basketball player getting signed to, you know, a team.
Uh-huh.
And then making this huge press conference, this huge announcement saying, all right, guys, brought you here today to let you guys know I'm wearing Nikes on my first game. That's what it felt like. That's what it felt like. I'm not gonna lie.
I'm wearing Nikes on.
You know,
I thought you were gonna say like the basketball dude's like running down the hall and he's about to, you know, come out and talk to the people, the press and everything, and all of a sudden he puts his back up against the wall and kind of backs down and he has a baby in his hand.
What?
And then and he starts running, and then here goes the Giger tank, you know.
I mean, that's kind of what I took away from it.
I think actually players have done that before.
Making press conferences for something so small like that?
Yes.
I'm sure.
I think they have. I think I want to say they have.
I'm sure they have. And that's exactly why I was like, well, this is the perfect analogy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But anyway, so yeah, I mean, I'm excited for the game. I will support Kojima in whatever he does, whatever it is. I still feel like that man has a filmmaker mind, and he needs to make the jump into movies.
That is never going to happen.
He needs to.
I don't think that's ever going to happen. I mean,
It probably not, but I think it would be great if he did. I think he could make an awesome
film. If that's the truth, if he never done anything, that dude needs to get punched in the stomach real hard, like really, really hard. Like, let's find the biggest, toughest dude, hold his arms out, punch him in the stomach, because like that's some talent, man. That really is. It's a lot of, you know, it's a lot of stuff that's come out of that yeah. head that people love. I mean, love,
if
man.
You look at all the Metal Gear games, they're all very like movie like, yeah, very cinematic.
You know, and people, you know? We love that stuff. And then for you, just we want you to do what you're supposed to be doing, and you're not doing it.
But like I said, either way, whatever he does, I mean, I'm gonna support him, whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, he has like this awesome mind, dude. Even I tell my wife, Monica, you know, the story, she's been along the ride with the story with me. I'm serious, because ever since that it got announced that, you know, Kojima was leaving, I was making this big deal about it. And this was probably the only thing that she was like, kind of semi-interested in. If you listen to the last podcast, you know, usually whenever I talk to her about stuff I'm interested in, she's like, I don't care. You know? Yeah. This is the only thing that she probably seems semi-interested in.
Yeah. Did you go, like when y'all found out, were you like,
right. I'm like, yes, that's a win.
Oh, it felt so good. I love you.
But so yeah, so I mean, I guess her side of it, the way or why she is interested in it,
so good,
is the business side.
Yeah,
and she's like, man, it's messed up. You know, like they ousted somebody that had this much pull over creative differences type of thing. Man. And it was unfair. You know? She's very business savvy, you know, about that stuff.
Man, I thought you were gonna say like she was like pulling for the game and then
No. She cared less about the game.
Oh my
But God. I think when somebody is like unfairly like when something is unjust or unfairly done to somebody, she's like, what the fuck?
I'm the same way too.
Man. So I think that's what interests her about it. But so she's been on the road, I guess, with me on the story, and I've kind of updated every time something new comes out. I'll tell her about it, and she's like, "Oh wow, like man, I'm glad that he's getting his chance now," kind of thing. So again, that's probably the only thing that she'll probably be like,
"Maybe he'll leave me alone for a little bit."
Yeah. Other than that, like 5 minutes later, I'm like, "Oh my God, Monica, did you see this?" Shut up. I'm kidding. She doesn't say shut up. But anyway.
Cool.
But anyway. So on that note, we're going to go ahead and end this episode of the Bot Squad podcast. We've taken up enough of your time. Really? Honestly, okay, hear me out. Before we go, this is a thought that I'm putting out there to the universe. All right? Since This YouTube stream has actually gone over really well, you know.
I forgot about the.
And I feel like, you know, a lot of people have interacted during this stream. this is the first episode that we've had on YouTube. We've kind of been Twitch based for a while now, this was kind of a test run. This has gone over really well. And
what are you doing?
No, I'm considering us doing maybe a very long live stream one day.
Okay.
Maybe sometime, I don't want to say sometime soon, but you know, there's a lot of people out there that do 24-hour live streams and stuff like that. Considering something like that, you know, people interchanging and playing games and stuff like that. So if you guys are interested in something like that, let us know in the comments, and we'll see if we can figure that out somehow. The other thing that I wanted to say real quick, before you go, that next episode.
Oh, that's what I was gonna say. When
is that next episode? We're gonna try to do it before Christmas. All right. Obviously, and as a special occasion.
That's what I meant when I asked, "What are you trying to do?"
Special occasion. I want you to let us know if we should do the Carolina Reaper.
Oh, okay. You know, I was about to ask something.
Or something to that degree. Anyway.
Okay. All right. And you know what? And this is going to help because Jay went to the Tamale Festival. What was that for?
Yeah, people sound
good. Here in Houston, they have this Tamale Festival. If you guys don't know what tamales are, if you're...
They're tamales.
You know, it's food. If you're Latino, and everybody knows what a tamale is, okay? But anyways, so they had this festival here, and my wife went. And she went with the wife of a good friend of ours, Sixto.
Okay.
Sixto's wife. So they went. Seduce. Somebody gave my wife a flyer, and it was called iBurn.com.
That's the place that I've told you about, that I was going to go get the stuff from the last
time. Oh, okay.
I know where it's at. We need to take a trip there.
Okay, well, she...
iBurn.com. Check it out for all your hot sauce needs and all that stuff. Not sponsored.
She said that there was a guy there. He had the Carolina Reaper sauce, and you can get it on there.
Yeah, we need to take a trip down there.
I was going to give it to you, even though I know it's going to end up fucking bad on my end.
It's going
to
be bad.
Yeah, I always lose. Anyways, So, you know, we'll see. And I was kind of hoping that, you know, at least we can get another one in before the end of the year or whatever. I'm good with that. So
yeah, we will.
All right, definitely. Cool.
All right, I'm
okay. I know there's more to this story.
Screw your comments. We're doing it. Right.
Okay. I know there's more to the story. So, I know there's.
We got to find a fun way to present it, though.
Yeah.
So I'll figure that out. If you guys have any ideas, let us know.
And the 74 guy, what was his name?
Oh, Malastal 79.
You better get that game and show us, man.
Yeah, dude. Tag us on Instagram. Cinema Deviant. Obviously, you know, you follow me, man. And then. What's your Bob Bang?
Bob Bang on which one?
On Instagram.
Oh, on Instagram. Oh yeah, it's Bob Bang 94.
And then so tag us on that if you do end up getting the Resident Evil thing.
Oh yeah.
So
yeah.
Anyway, we're gonna go to end this episode of the Bot Squad podcast. Keep visiting cinemadeviant.com for all your movies, news, reviews, trailers. Facebook.com/cinemadeviant. Like I said, Instagram cinemadeviant, Twitter @cinemadeviant, Tumblr tumblr.com/cinemadeviant. Am I missing something? Snapchat. Cinema Deviant. And what are your social networks?
Instagram BobBang94. Snapchat and Twitter is both of them the same. Spawn94AEW. And then on Facebook, man. I like to be on Facebook.
The Bot Squad.
The Bot Squad Podcast.
Facebook.com says Bot Squad Podcast. So go give that page a like.
Oh, you know what? And we got to do this before the end of the year. I'm gonna try to find something, and I think I have something at home. But let's try to do another giveaway, at least just for
you know what?
This will be 70.
Yeah, it will be.
It'll be 70.
Yeah, so we'll go ahead and do it on the next podcast. We'll do it. We'll announce a giveaway on the next podcast for you guys. So, on that note, and with that being said, we will catch you next time.
Cheers, man.
Bye.